chair this, Ignacio Antonio.
Okay, so let's start for today. Good morning or good afternoon to everybody. So our first speaker will be Irene Valenzuela, who is going to give a review talk on Swampland.
Okay, so thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you to the organizers for putting together this conference in this difficult year and for the invitation to speak. So it's really an honor and a pleasure for me to give a review talk on the Swampland program at the Spring Conference. So I decided to focus on the progress that we have made in the past 2 years, since Matt Rees gave a Swampland review in Brussels 2 years ago. So I'm gonna tell you what has changed since then, what we understand better, and what we still need to understand. And still, it has been very difficult to summarize everything in of 2 years in 40 minutes, so I apologize already if I am missing something or not discussing other things in the detail they would deserve. Okay, so the big question that we try to answer with the Swampland program is what effective field theories at low energy that are weakly coupled to Einstein gravity are consistent at the quantum level. Okay, so they have a UV completion in quantum gravity. And the point is that not everything goes. And this is the same way that Leonardo started his review talk on Monday, that not every effective field theory, which is valid up to some cutoff, can be UV completed in a consistent theory of quantum gravity, unless it satisfies some additional constraints. So we say that those theories that look apparently consistent from a low energy perspective, but cannot be UV completed, belong to the Swampland, while those that can arise as low energy limits of a consistent theory of quantum gravity, like string theory, belong to the landscape. And the goal is to understand what distinguishes the landscape from the swamp. So what are these constraints, no, that the EFT has to satisfy from the low energy perspective, no, written in a low energy perspective language. Now, of course, this is a very ambitious and very important goal at the same time, because we are trying to understand what is the UV imprint of quantum gravity at low energies. And clearly, it's very hard to prove in complete generality any of these constraints because we don't have the framework to do so. But I think we can use all we have learned from string theory during all these years to try to identify patterns and try to gather as much evidence as we can for them from all the perspectives and techniques we can think of and we have developed during all this time. Because any small progress in this direction, I think it's huge because it's eventually trying to connect string theory and quantum gravity to the real world. So we have, following this spirit, we have some proposals that we call Swampland conjectures, and then are typically motivated by string theory and black hole physics. Now, this is a map of the conjectures that we had 2 years ago when Matt Rees gave the review. And let me not explain right now what they are exactly. It will become clear during the talk, but let me just remark that I have put in purple three of them, which we will see they are at the core of the Swampland program. And these years we've been gathering more evidence for them, understanding better, and also I think one of the most important developments is that there are emerging many relations among the conjectures that are suggesting that they are not independent, random statements, but they all seem to be connected and they might be just different phases of the same quantum gravity underlying principles that we are starting to uncover. So one of the goals is precisely try to understand these relations very well and see if we can use them to reduce the conjectures to the minimum number of statements that would reproduce everything. Okay. Okay, so how do we do that? So there is not a single approach. There are many different approaches you can take to try to gather evidence for these statements. And I think this slide represents very well the Swampland program in the sense that it's not just a bunch of people using the same techniques to study different problems, but it's more like a combination of different people with different backgrounds and using different techniques trying to answer the same question. So I decided that instead of structuring my talk following the different conjectures as usual, I'm going to structure it following the different approaches that are used to gather evidence for the conjectures, so that I can explain you what we have learned in each case. So this is going to be my outline. I'm going to start with the topological operators and follow with string compactifications. And then I will discuss a bit ADS-CFT, positivity constraints, and black holes. Although most of the time will be dedicated to the first two, since it's where most of the work has been done. And I will finish discussing a bit the phenomenological implications. Okay, so let's start. So the first point about topological operators and coordination is focused on understanding the absence of global symmetries in quantum gravity. Okay, so this is one of the oldest and I would say most widely accepted conjectures, meaning that any global symmetry must be broken or gauged. And it has, even if it's an old conjecture, actually it has received a lot of attention in the past 2 years, because we have realized that it's more powerful and has more implication than what we thought some time ago. And this comes together because of this generalized notion of symmetries that give rise to a new zoo of symmetries to explore, and that has also triggered a lot of activity in the QFT community, as we will see next week. So my message here is that we can learn a lot, not only from the presence, but also from the absence of these symmetries. And one of the goals, for example, is try to understand what are the precise mechanisms by which quantum gravity avoids all these symmetries. So just to give you one example, we can reinterpret many familiar known physics in string theory as consequences of avoiding symmetries, global symmetries. So for example, systems of actions, Sir-Simons, localized degrees of freedom, brains dissolving on brains, and so on, can be understood as consequences of avoiding what we call these Chernobyl global symmetries, whose currents are given by products of the gauge field strengths. And this might point out that maybe if one, the absence of global symmetries is something general of quantum gravity, all these top-down features could be more general as well. So here I'm talking about topological charges that involve gauge fields, but you could also wonder what about topological charges that involve gravity. And there is a well-defined and precise notion to classify all these topological global charges based on coordination classes. Okay, so precisely the idea of avoiding to have all these topological global charges is what led Jake and Kobrun to formulate this coordination conjecture, which has received a lot of attention in the past 2 years. So the statement is that the coordination group of a quantum gravity theory must be trivial, because otherwise non-trivial topological charges, coordination classes, would correspond to different topological global charges that would give rise to a D minus K minus one for global symmetry, where D is the total dimension and K is the internal dimension of the compactification. Now, in order to explain how to understand this conjecture and this object, let me briefly first give the intuition of the geometric notion of the coordination group. So basically, if you have two manifolds, they are on the same class, this coordination, if their union is the boundary of another manifold one dimension more. Okay, so for example, then if you belong to the trivial class, it means that the manifold is a boundary by itself. Okay, so it can be shrink. Now, if we compactify string theory on these manifolds, the existence of this relation, of this coordination, is a domain wall that interpolates between the two effective field theories that come from compactifying string theory on the two manifolds. And the case of the trivial class corresponds to an end of the world brain where there is nothing behind. So the way to understand this conjecture is that all effective field theories or theories of the same dimension must be connected by finite energy domain walls. Okay, so that means that if you have some compactification of string theory and you compute what is the geometric coordination group and you obtain that is non-zero, it means, I mean, the way you should understand it is that it means that you are missing something, that you are missing some defect that would trivialize this coordination group and that is necessary for quantum gravity consistency. So for example, if you have fluxes, this would tell you that you need to have brains and so on. And therefore it can be used to predict the existence of new defects in string theory, which can even be non-supersymmetric. Okay, so this has been used in this quest of string universality to show that any FT consistent with quantum gravity arises from string theory, so that we can get everything that is consistent, which would be amazing, because then it means that the lessons that we get are not a matter of the lamppost. And there has been a lot of activity in the past years about this, trying to use swamp plan constraints, anomaly cancellation, and a high-level supersymmetry to classify the possible EFTs and check if they have string theory embedding. And here I put some of the words, but let me, since Kumrun later on, and so Mariana will discuss about this, and it will also appear in the discussion later on by Gary and Miriam, let me not say more about this and continue with other topics. So I wanted to say one more thing about this cohortism theory, which is an implication that has for the stability of our vacuum using bubbles of nothing. So a bubble of nothing is this non-perturbative stability, which a bubble of nothing nucleates in space-time. And it's a perfectly smooth solution constructed by Witten for the case of a circle, in which it's very important that a compact manifold can shrink to zero size at the wall of the bubble. So it was constructed for the circle, but you can do it more generally. And the point is that this is allowed if the compact space can shrink to a point, which should already sound familiar to you, because that means that it's the boundary of another manifold. And as I told you, this is possible if our compact manifold belongs to the trivial class in Bordesian group. So the statement that the co-Bordesian group must vanish in quantum gravity implies that there's no topological obstruction to have bubbles of nothing. Of course, this is only at the topological level. Then one has to study whether it is energetically favorable for the bubble to expand. And this is related to whether it violates some energy condition at the level of the classical Lagrangian. And this is something that has to be studied more. We have constructed some examples in which, indeed, when supersymmetry is broken by the vacuum, even if it's not broken by the theory, this can happen. But it's interesting because it opens a new avenue to try to show this other conjecture, which claims that any non-supersymmetry vacuum should eventually decay. And that was motivated by different means. Okay, so this brings some correlation between the absence of global symmetries and this statement. And following this quest of unifying conjectures and reduce them to a few number of principles, there has also been work relating the completeness hypothesis and the absence of global symmetries, which I will tell you about next. Okay, so the completeness hypothesis is the statement that there are physical charge states for all possible charges of the Gibbs group that are consistent with Dirac quantization. And the question I want to address here is whether this conjecture, which is also a very old conjecture, actually follows from the absence of global symmetry. So they are not independent statements. And this is a question that can be purely addressed from the low energy effective field theory perspective. And for that, it's useful to, instead of talking of global symmetries, to talk about topological operators that characterize the symmetries. And the notion of a complete spectrum gets translated to the statement that all charged operators can end. So just in Maxwell theory, to give an example, we have famous one for global symmetry with characterized by this topological operator, where the current is just the field strength. And the charged operators are Wilson lines that can break if we have charged states in the theory, right? If we have electrons. But then if they can break, it means that we can unlink the topological operator, shrink it, and then we get a trivial axon, which would be in contradiction. So the one for global symmetry is broken. The operator cannot be topological anymore. And only if we have a complete spectrum, the one for global symmetry gets fully broken. So you could wonder whether this is a general feature, okay? So whether no topological operators or no global symmetries happen if an olive or extended object charge operators can end. So we have a complete spectrum. And this is true for continuous groups, but it's not true in general for discrete or disconnected groups. However, it seems it can be true if we allow for a more general notion of symmetry, in which we allow for also for non-invertible topological operators. So here I'm just going to refer to Suhan's review to explain what more detail what these non-invertible topological operators are. And let me simply point out that we've been able to prove this one-to-one correspondence in a number of cases. So for example, for discrete gauge theories in 3D TQFT, and also for the electric completeness, no, of the charge electric spectrum for general compact gauge groups in any dimension, as long as they are only coupled to matter, and the analogous of twist vortices charge under the -2 form symmetries. Okay, so the lesson that we can extract from all this is that I think we are in the process of understanding what is precisely the notion of symmetry that is forbidden in quantum gravity. These results suggest that maybe no global symmetry should be replaced by no topological operators, or more generally, no co-vortices classes. And of course, we have to understand how to formulate this better and why this is the case. But intuitively, I think it can make sense because topology itself is dynamical in quantum gravity. So probably it doesn't make sense to have topological operators, whether they are invertible or non-invertible, and because they are not well defined. And this is something that actually connects with recent developments to prove the absence of global symmetries based on unitary black hole evaporation, because the relevance of topology change in quantum gravity has also been clear in the recent derivation of the unitary page curve. And in this paper, they argue that this also is going to forbid the absence of global symmetries. More concretely, one can see that they are violated by the replica wormholes using the derivation, or more generally, by topology changing processes. Okay, so this is all I wanted to say about exact global symmetries. The next point is going to be string compactifications, but before that, let me make a brief comment, hopefully brief, about approximate global symmetries. So the next question that should come to your mind is, okay, maybe I accept there are no global symmetries in quantum gravity, but what about approximate ones? How approximate the symmetry can be? Can we quantify how close we can get to restoring the global symmetry? Because this can have a lot of implications for the effective field theories, if we can say how much we have to break them. And we can try to engineer some global symmetry by varying the parameters of the EFT. So this corresponds to moving in the moduli space. And then, I mean, how quantum gravity fixes this is because it pushes these points in which a global symmetry is restored to be at infinite distance. Okay, and then when we approach the points, the EFT breaks down in a continuous way, meaning that the UV cutoff goes to zero. Okay. Now, how exactly goes to zero and what is the physics that forces this can be, for example, quantified by these other important conjectures, which are the distance and the weak gravity conjecture. So since I will talk a lot about them, let me define what they are now. So the distance conjecture is the statement that in general, when we approach these infinite distance boundaries in the moduli space, we get an infinite tower of states that becomes exponentially light in terms of the geodesic distance. So indeed, the UV cutoff goes to zero because we cannot have infinitely many fields weakly coupled to Einstein gravity. And this implies an upper bound on the field range for an effective field theory that an effective field theory can accommodate when it has a finite cutoff. Okay. So we'll see one of the most important open questions here is exactly what is this exponential rate. And I will show you the progress that we have made in this regard. Now, the weak gravity conjecture says that given a Gibbs theory, there must exist an electrically charged state with a charge to mass ratio bigger than the value of the extremal black hole in that theory. So this is again another one factor that can be determined from EFT data. Here the question is, what is the state that satisfies the gravity conjecture? So in this sense, there is a strong version motivated by string theory and modular invariance of the CFT2 that claims that there is not just one, but there are actually infinitely many states, so that they form a sublattice or a tower of states that satisfy the gravity conjecture. And here then the connection with global symmetries is even more clear because we can send the gauge coupling of a theory to zero. Okay, so this charge is the physical charge that depends on the gauge coupling. And this is going to be at infinite distance because it restores a global symmetry, a U1 global symmetry. And then according to the good gravity, the cutoff of the theory goes to zero and we again get this infinite tower of states becoming life. So of course the weak gravity conjecture is valid beyond weak coupling and it's also associated to black hole physics and so on. But let me now focus just on these asymptotic regions because all these conjectures, what are telling us is that to have approximate global symmetries, weakly coupled gauge theories, large field ranges, all these things come at a price. Okay, and it's precisely in these corners where they predict the existence of new light states that can have an effect on the EFT and imply that the UV cutoff should go to zero. And in these towers, as I said, can have an effect and can be behind many of the universal patterns that we observe for the effective field theories that emerge at the asymptotic limits in the modular space. And here I'm talking about any limit in the modular space, not just small string coupling, okay? This is not just about perturbative string theory. Okay, so this understanding better these universal patterns that appear and the relation to the towers is what has given rise to many of the relations among the Swan-Plank conjectures. Okay, so that's this weak gravity and distance constrain the spectra. And this, for example, can have implications on the scalar potential, as we see. Okay, so then let me go to the next point, string compactification. So these ideas are very nice, but we have to try to check it. Especially it's very useful to check these asymptotic limits to take string theory compactifications. Because there, even if we lose some universality, we can provide quantitative and rigorous tests of the conjectures, which can sharpen them and fix all these order one factors so that at least we can be confident of what is the precise statement that is realized in large classes of compactifications. So just for example, we can provide a lower bound for the exponential rate of these towers, which is valid for any Calabi-Yau manifold, any Calabi-Yau form. Okay. And not only that, but we also understand the meaning of this number. So in the end, there are very few possibilities that are allowed, which are fixed by the discrete symmetries, the discrete monodromy symmetry that characterize the different limits. Now, understanding this, like checking these conjectures in string theory has also been useful to uncover new universal geometric properties of the compactification manifolds that were not known or that were conjectured by mathematicians by different means. So here I have some examples, like for example, this has triggered a systematic classification of the infinite distance singularities in Calabi-Yau manifolds using Mischel structures, which is also something very active right now in mathematics. And it's very useful to not just to classify the limits, but also to understand the physics around the limits, which has triggered this proposal of modular space holography, in which one tries to recover the geometry deeper in the modular space from the information from the discrete data that we have at the infinite distance boundaries. There are also beautiful connections between algebraic geometry of Calabi-Yau and modular properties of quasi-Jacobi forms. And also by studying infinite flop chains in length theory and Calabi-Yau threefold, people saw that the distance conjecture implies this previously formulated mathematical conjecture by Kawamata and Morrison. Okay, so most of the work, let me remark, that has been done has been devoted to identify the towers of states that are becoming light at the infinite distance limit. So they provide a confirmation both for the distance and the gravity conjecture. And here we have followed a very systematic approach in which there has been a lot of activity, especially for theories with 8 supercharges and the towers of PP states, because there it's non-trivial that the conjectures are satisfied. So it's interesting to understand how. And at the moment, we have a very complete and solid understanding, I would say, of what's going on in these theories. So in the past 2 years, the progress actually has been made in trying to reduce the level of supersymmetry. Okay, so for example, trying to understand what happens in 4D and equals 1. So since I said I'm going to focus on the past 2 years, then let me just say a few words about 4D and equals 1 theories. The goal is to understand them at the same level that we understand now the case of 8 supercharges. And at the moment, it seems that all examples point to the universal presence of a weakly coupled VPS action stream that becomes tensionless at the infinite distance limit, which can, it means that we can map infinite distance limits with RG flowing points of the stream, which allows for a bottom-up derivation of the distance conjecture if the stream satisfies the weak gravity. Now, I don't have time to discuss these things in detail, but let me also point out that the stream doesn't need to be the leading tower. There can be other towers becoming light, like, for example, KK towers. But it seems that so far there is a very constrained correlation between these other towers and the string tension, so that the mass is proportional to an integral power of the string tension. And in all the examples so far, we only find 3 possible values. So it's also very constrained, as in 4D n equals 2. And why we only get these 3 values, for me, it's still a mystery, actually. So this is consistent also with this refinement of the distance conjecture, claiming that every infinite distance limit should correspond either to the compactification or some stream perturbative limit, no? In which we have some stream becoming tensionless and we pick up. And it would be interesting to understand this further to see whether we can find other types of limits or other types of dualities, right? Because the tower is very linked to the existence of dualities at infinite distance limits. Okay, so the reason why we're also studying 4D n equals 1 is because we want to understand what happens with the distance conjecture in the presence of a scalar potential so that we can use it for phenomenology. In particular, we want to understand whether the values of the potential also satisfy the distance conjecture, even if they are not geodesics from the UV perspective, but axiom monodromy trajectories. And here, in principle, I can say that they should, because if we want the distance conjecture to be consistent at energy scale, because we can always integrate out the heavy modes and apply the conjecture in the IR pseudo-moduli space. So they should satisfy it, but then it's highly non-trivial because it means that the conjecture itself is putting constraints on the potential that are consistent with quantum gravity, because not every trajectory should be allowed. And this is something that has to be checked and understand better. But at the moment, what we know is that they do satisfy the distance conjecture in the case of Calabi-Yau-Flass compactifications. Okay. And it would be nice to understand this more generally and other setups. Okay, so just to finish the string compactifications, I want to briefly mention a bit other Somplan related questions which are issues which are not settled yet, but have triggered, we have had a lot of activity because they are very important problems, and there is a lot of recent activity about them triggered by the Swan-Plan conjectures. So the first one is the scale separation in ADS. So we have this ADS distance conjecture, which comes from generalizing the distance conjecture, not just moving in the moduli space, but moving on the space of metric configurations connecting different vacuum. So if one takes this generalization, it means that one can see that the flat space limit is at infinite distance, so that there should be an infinite tower of states becoming light that scale with the cosmological constant, so that we cannot have pure ADS without some internal space or some origin of the tower. Now, there is a strong version which bounds the exponent. This is like try to bound the exponent of the distance conjecture of the tower, which would mean that there's no scale separation in ADS. between the external and internal dimensions. Now, this has triggered research in string constructions, trying to find counterexamples of this, and revisiting in particular this model of the Wolf et al., which is these are potential counterexamples coming from massive tight way, which are counterexamples to the strong version, okay, so the value of alpha, but not to the mild version. So they all have always the towers of states. And the question is, what is the exponent? Now, they are potential counterexamples because the 10-dimensional uplift is not completely known in these cases. So it's not clear, but there has been recent developments this year, and so far the model survives. Now, for the case of the sitter, as you can imagine, there is also a lot of activity. There are two avenues you can take, two lines of research. One is to try to determine whether there is the sitter at parametric control near these infinite distance limits, because sometimes the best way to find something is to find out where it's not. And surprisingly, even if we don't have any example, it's not excluded. And it's not clear why we don't have one, like why we cannot have some sitter at parametric control. So far it seems that there is always this universal behavior that we always get a runaway towards infinite distance, which is consistent with an asymptotic version of the sitter conjecture that the potential satisfies this inequality. And it's kind of a generalized dime cyber problem, but that is valid not just for perturbative string theory, but for any direction in the moduli space. Okay. So understanding this better has given rise to new no-goes for the sitter, and also works determining exactly what are these factors in the context of string theory. And as I said, trying to understand why we have this runaway. So in this direction, some proposals is that the runaway indeed can be shown to be a consequence of the towers of states that are becoming light. And also in 4DN equals one, one can map this to the fact that we can interpret the scalar potential as the charge of some membrane, and this membrane saturates the weak gravity conjecture. Okay, so the other avenue is to go beyond parametric control, and then we have the famous proposals of KKLFT and Lars Follin scenario, where there has been recent progress, although there is no fully controlled global description yet. But we will have a full discussion about this tomorrow, so let me not say more, and simply finish this with a comment that, of course, one solution is that it might be that the sitter is forbidden asymptotically, but allowed deeper in the bulk. And then the question is, how metastable can it be? What is the lifetime? So I just want to briefly mention that in this direction, there is this Trans-Planckian sensor-state conjecture, which allows for the sitter deeper in the bulk as long as it is short-lived.
And you have 7 minutes.
So then let's go, I think this to the next 3 points, which will be very quick in comparison, and finish with the phenomenological implications. So for AES-CFT, I think the Sonplan program is very similar in the spirit to all the conformal bootstrap approach. We are trying to determine what is the space of consistent theories. And there are many correlations between the two programs. I just want to remark some things of the past 2 years. So, one can try to translate these Sonplan conjectures to statements in the CFT so that they can be proven by different means. And for example, we have this CFT version of the distance conjecture, in which we basically connect this three notion of infinite distance, free point, and higher spin towers. So we propose that at infinite distance in the conformal manifold, measured by the Samoyedov metric, we always get a free CFT. It's a free point, and therefore there is a high spin symmetry. Okay, so some of these directions can actually be proven in superconformal field theories in the sense that if we get the high spin tower, we can show that in superconformal field theories we need to have free vectors, so the gauge capping, there is a gauge capping that goes to zero, and then indeed it's going to be at infinite distance. And one can show just by perturbation theory that the anomalous dimension, so how much it deviates from the unitary bound, decays exponentially in terms of this distance. So it's the analogous of the distance conjecture. Now, when we have a weakly coupled EDS dual, indeed we can reproduce the distance conjecture and provide a strong version because we are specifying the spin. And we can also tell exactly, compute what is the exponential rate, which in Planck units is going to be given by the ratio of the central charge and the dimension of the gauge group getting free. So it gives an interpretation of these exponential rates in terms of what portion of the field is getting free, right? Like you are trying to decouple things and that has an effect. And it also gives a lower bound for alpha because the dimension of the gauge group cannot be bigger than the central charge. And let me recall that lower bounds is what we need to give upper bounds on the field edge. So this is if we have a weakly coupled dual, but actually the conjecture should be valid beyond Einstein gravity, which makes me wonder also to what extent some of the Swan-Planck conjectures, even if they are originally formulated for weakly coupled theories, sometimes might hint deeper principles of quantum gravity. And here I just wanted to mention other works of testing the weak gravity for non-holographic CFTs. Okay, so this is ADS CFT. Let me then quickly say a few words about positivity constraints and black holes. So for positivity constraints, there are amazing new developments that we have seen in Leonardo's review about bounding higher derivative terms on EFT with decoupled gravity, which is also a way to quantify what is in the landscape and what is in the Swan-Planck. Now, since we already had a review, let me just add one more thing, which is that positivity constraints have also been used to try to prove some mild version of the weak gravity conjecture by studying higher derivative corrections to the black holes. So one can aim to show that these higher derivative corrections are positive using unitarity and causality so that small black holes themselves could satisfy the weak gravity, and this is what we call the mild version. And there have been works, extended these works by adding scalar fields, and the conclusion is that unitarity and causality is not completely enough to show the weak gravity unless some additional mild Hubie structure is satisfied. But for example, this can be just assuming that there is an SL2C symmetry preserved by the higher derivative terms. Okay, and regarding black holes, there has also been works testing the weak gravity conjecture in black hole solution, especially adding scalar fields, because something interesting happens, which is that the super extremality condition that we use to define the weak gravity is different now that a repulsive force condition, in the sense that gravity acts weaker. So these were like the two interpretations of the weak gravity, and then one could get the impression that there are two different ways to define the conjecture. However, this difference actually disappears for extremal black holes or the towers of asymptotically massless states at the weak coupling limits. So this brings a nice interplay with the distance conjecture because precisely because these two notions coincide, no, for these towers, we can use the black hole extremality bound to provide a bound on the exponential rate of the tower and fix these order one factors in the distance conjecture. And this is valid whenever there is a p-form gauge coupling vanishing at infinite distance, which happens so far in all the examples, and I personally believe that might be general. Okay. So this is all I wanted to say about the different approaches. I'm going to finish with the phenomenological implications, but before, let me just summarize quickly some of these ideas.
We have 3 minutes.
Okay, 3 minutes to summarize and define implications. So we said that there are these three main conjectures from which many of the other things can be derived. We saw how that this can be encoded in the notion of non-topological operators and endability. And from the weak gravity and the distance conjecture, there are also new ideas that have appeared, which I wouldn't call them new conjectures, but new generalizations or spin-offs coming from applying these conjectures in different setups. So let me take this as an opportunity to flash what are the other ideas and work that has been done that I didn't have time to discuss. And unfortunately, I don't have time to discuss now in detail. But from the weak gravity conjecture, there are different ideas coming from thinking along the same lines on black hole physics or scalar fields, like trying to understand if there is a scalar version of the weak gravity conjecture, which can also be used to provide the exponential behavior of the distance conjecture. And for the case of the distance, there are also different works that have appeared, taking the same logic of requiring the presence of an infinite tower at infinite distance. But instead of thinking of moduli space, thinking of distances in different space, different spaces. And then there are also ideas regarding the sitter and the possible stability. Okay, so I'm gonna finish. I think I just need a couple of minutes for the phenomenological implications. So all this, I mean, it's nice and it's interesting by itself to understand what are the quantum gravity constraints, but I think the reason why we had had so much activity on the Swan Plan program in the past years is also because of the potential phenomenological implications. Because we are giving constraints that can be used as new guiding principles to construct beyond standard model proposals and can hopefully also bring new insights to solve the naturalness issues in our universe. So the point here is that not everything goes in string theory, we know that. We have to understand better what is possible or not. But if not the entire parameter space is consistent with quantum gravity, I think this means that we have to revisit the notion of fine-tuning and the logic of naturalness. So here, this is just a list of the different words that have appeared in the past 2 years using the Swan Plan conjectures to constrain different models in inflation, dark energy, beyond standard model, naturalness issues. Of course, I'm not going to discuss all this. I just want to show you some pictorial diagram of what are the possible phenomenological implications coming from each of the conjectures. So clearly, from the global symmetries, we can constrain models with very well approximate global symmetries. From the weak gravity constraint models that have small gauge couplings or large axionic decay constants. From the distance conjecture, models with large field ranges, the sitter is clear. And then there are also works constraining the hierarchy problem and providing some insights into naturalness issues. I find this very exciting because I think it's a very exciting possibility that quantum gravity can be behind all these naturalness issues and it can change the logic of naturalness and the expectation of scale separation. And I'm going to finish, this is going to be my last slide. I want to finish remarking what we can tell about naturalness coming from the Swan Plan program and just highlighting the works that have appeared in the past 2 years in this topic. So there are works that we can apply the sitter conjecture to constrain quark masses and the theta angle and also give a bound on the electroweak hierarchy problem under certain assumptions. Also requiring that cycle compactifications of an EFT satisfy the Swan Plan conjectures, we get that in a SUSY broken EFT with zero or positive cosmological constant and this condition in the super trace, there must exist a surplus of light fermions with masses below the cosmological constant. So this applied to the standard model, it explains the numerical coincidence between neutrinos and the cosmological constant, and also implies that they should be Dirac unless there is some light fermion in dark matter. And finally, the Festina-Lente proposal, which I didn't have time to discuss, but it's like thinking along the lines of the weak gravity conjecture for black holes in the sitter. One derives that all charged particles must satisfy this inequality in terms of the gauge coupling and the Hubble scale. So it also provides an explanation for the electroweak hierarchy problem. Now, all these are examples which break this logic of naturalness because they provide non-trivial correlations between the IR observables that seem unnatural from a low energy perspective. In particular, the last two relate the electroweak hierarchy problem and the cosmological constant problem. And of course, you should take all this with a grain of salt because they all have additional assumptions that we can hopefully discuss later in the discussion. So maybe they are just coincidences, but maybe not. And I think that these, at the very least, motivate us to understand this conjecture better and try to gather evidence for them from all the perspectives we can think of. Okay. So I'm going to finish here with the same way that I started, because it's very important to consider many different approaches because it's only when we get when using different approaches and different corners that assume different things and we still get to the same ideas that we start thinking, only then that we start thinking that there is something behind, and hopefully eventually being able to apply these ideas to finally connect string theory to the real world. So thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Other questions? I see Tolga.
I don't hear anything.
Ivano Basil?
Oh, yeah, hi.
Hello.
So thank you very much for the very nice review. I have a question about a specific detail of the distance conjecture.
Mm-hmm.
Specifically, I was wondering, would you say it's only sensible to consider trajectories in field space such that each point in the trajectory corresponds to a physically possible web of the fields? I mean,
you mean a vacuum?
I'm sorry, what?
You mean a vacuum, like it's a possible
essentially, vacuum. Yeah. What I mean is, does each point have to be such that if the fields took that constant value everywhere, it would be a vacuum?
So, I mean, originally it's formulated by moving in the field space, so every point is a vacuum. But I think it can be more general than that. Like, if there is a reason why we get these infinite towers at the end, we could try also to approach the point by discrete steps and get the tower in the end. So what is more difficult is how to formulate this distance in that case.
Yeah.
So we have to understand, I mean, the tower is decaying exponentially in terms of what exactly.
Right.
But if the presence of the tower is linked to what happens at the asymptotic limit, I think it should be independent of how we approach it.
Because, I mean, I guess it makes sense considering a recent paper of yours that if the fields are massive but still light compared to a relevant scale, you can think of a suitable pseudo-moduli space, right? But I was
Exactly. I think that in physics grounds, whether it's exactly massless or just very light compared to the energy that of the effective field theory, I mean, it shouldn't be such a drastic
difference. Right. But I was wondering whether there's people that just consider any arbitrary trajectory in the space of fields and not necessarily backward.
Well, I think you have to be careful with that because every arbitrary trajectory is not going to give always the exponential behavior.
Right.
So
you Sandeep Trivedi was asking a question.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ignatius, but I just saw on the chat Daniel had a question which I was going to ask. Maybe Daniel has his hand up, he can ask it, otherwise I can ask it later. Sorry.
I guess maybe Sandeep and I have the same question. So I was just a little bit surprised when you said that you think that asymptotic weakly coupled de Sitter solutions are not excluded. So I'm not an expert, but my impression was that they're pretty general theorems that at least morally excluded. So can you elaborate on that?
Yeah, no, I mean, they're beautiful no-go theorems, but they always have some assumption. Like, for example, I mean, they are excluded in, like, depending what is the sources that you have, what are the types of brains and oriented for and so on. So even like the Maldacena-Nunez theorem, right? It depends, like, it doesn't work if you don't have supergravity ingredients, like other type of oriented force and so on. And there are different no-goes, but again, they all depend on what ingredients you are putting in the compactification. So there is no general no-go for that.
But I would have thought to have a continuous parameter, you kind of need to have unbroken supersymmetry. Maybe that's incorrect, but, and we know that you can't have unbroken supersymmetry in de Sitter.
But I mean, you can have some de Sitter vacuum and then go to zero, I mean, with the potential and the question. I mean, I can just engineer some scalar potential in which you have some metastable de Sitter vacuum.
But that still sounds isolated. I thought you, when you said asymptotic, I thought, to me, that means there's a family of de Sitter solutions that go off to some weak coupling limit.
I mean,
that's
that,
not what you meant.
No, I mean that it happens, it can happen at parametric control in the sense of this, in these near asymptotic regions. So
is KKLT an example of that?
No, KKLT is not, because it's not just about the perturbative potential. It's really, you really need a balance, right, between the non-perturbative and the perturbative effect. So you cannot push this vacuum to large values, I mean, to the asymptotic region.
When you say push, I think you mean there's a family, right?
There can be, I mean, there, okay, that depends on whether these continuous parameters that you are varying, like the fluxes and so on, you can just vary in such a way that you get a family because maybe they are not bounded by tadpole cancellation or things like that. I'm thinking more general terms. Maybe, I mean, depends. But if we are thinking of flux compactifications, yeah, it would be like a family.
Maybe I'll leave to Sandeep if he has anything.
No, that's very helpful. So, Irina, I mean, many of the old no-go theorems were within the context of, say, classical supergravity, even in the presence of
yeah, exactly.
And so on. And are you saying that they, of course, hold, but the window is not definitely shut?
Exactly. So they all are very nice and they all fold, but most of them, many are about classical supergravity. Many of them are also about weak string coupling or large volume, mm-hmm. things like this. And there are mm-hmm. many more asymptotic limits that you can take in the moduli space. Like we are thinking about the full moduli space in lower compactifications. It's not just everything about small string coupling and large volume. Like we can move mm-hmm. to different corners in complex structure moduli space and other things. Mm-hmm. And there it's not, I mean, all these theories based on perturbative supergravity are not valid. And nice. Still, when we do it, we get the same behavior. So it seems that there is something more general that is not associated to perturbative string coupling or a supergravity description that mm-hmm. appears at every and any asymptotic limit of the moduli space.
I see. Even after dualities and so on, perhaps, huh? There are corners which you can't, yeah, okay.
I mean, one can always say that by dualities, everything will be connected, but I don't know, let's say.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
I think we have to stop here because the time